I'm no stranger to the prison. I've worn shackles and chains, but I've been freed and forgiven. I'm not going back. I'll never be the same. That's why I sing, oh, my hope is in Jesus. I thank God my yesterday's gone, and all my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. Come on and sing, oh, my hope is in Jesus. Yes, it is. I thank God my yesterday's gone, and all my sins are forgiven. Oh, I've been washed by the blood. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
All right, amen and amen. It's so good to be back once again, standing behind this sacred desk here at Valley Hill Baptist Church. And I wish each and every one of you were here as well. And it's just so good. All my hope is in Jesus. And I'm so grateful that I am under His blood, washed by His blood. And, you know, we're still proclaiming the cross here at Valley Hill Baptist Church. And I'm proud of this cross and for what it means and what it represents. And I love that old rugged cross. And we love the cross. We don't worship the cross, but we worship what took place there, that completed work of the cross. And thank you, Jesus, for everything that you have done for us and continue to do for us, continue to bless us. And oh, how grateful I am that all our hope is in Jesus, that we've been washed by that blessed blood. You know, we're having to do things a little different here, is some things that we've never had to do before. But I thank God that we're able to still reach out to one and all, and maybe even to people that may not, we would have never been able to reach otherwise. So it's good. If you've never seen any of our services here at Valley Hill Baptist Church, my name is David Woody, and I'm the pastor here at Valley Hill Baptist Church, and what we like to call beautiful Hendersonville. And so we'd like to welcome you, if you're watching this maybe for the first time, and all the regular congregation from Valley Hill Baptist Church, Brookdale, all our friends and family, we welcome you today as well. And it's just so good to be able to come together, even though it's over the internet, even though it's over the airwaves at times, but to open up the bread of life, God's holy word. I am so grateful for everything that God has done for us and continues to do for us. And today's title of the message is Let Go and Let God. But before we begin our sermon, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll open up in prayer. And wherever you may be, I would invite you just to bow your head and close your eyes, and just pray along with us as we pray. We may be separated by miles, but God can bring us together through this sweet hour of prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much, Lord. Give us another beautiful day, Lord, to serve you, Lord. We're not worthy to stand behind this sacred desk, Lord. And I thank you so much, Lord, for that privilege just to get to open up your precious word and break the word of life, Lord, and share it with your people, Lord. Lord, give me the words to say, Lord. Give me the words and the message to preach today with boldness and with courage. Lord, that it would be the words that you would have your people hear today, Lord. Keep the wrong words far from my lips, Lord. Give me exactly what you would have me to say. Let me be your mouthpiece today. Just anoint me, the Holy Spirit. And I pray all this and ask it in the sweet name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Wherever you may be today, we like to sing praise choruses here at our church. And This is one of our recent ones that we sang here just before we were all quarantined. but we like to sing a different one every month. And this time, this month, we're going to sing the song, "Isn't the Love of Jesus Something Wonderful?" Oh, isn't it wonderful? Isn't it marvelous? So let's all sing together. "Isn't the Love of Jesus Something Wonderful? Wonderful, wonderful. Oh, isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful? Wonderful it is to me." Let's do it again. "Isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful? Wonderful, wonderful. Isn't the love of Jesus something wonderful? Wonderful it is to me." Amen and amen. Well, as we're taking a look this month, and for this series, actually, we'll probably be in this more than just one month. I've already been into it probably a month by now, but it's in Joshua chapter 5. We're going to take a look at this today. And I'm impressed, once again, by God's timing. God's timing is perfect. And today's message goes along with so much that we see going along really in our own lives. Why would God allow something so serious to bring our lives so much disruption? You know, so many people are being affected right now, and no one seems to know really for how long it's going to last. There's people that's hurting. There's people that are dying with what's going on. The enemy seems to be everywhere. Every country in the world has it inside its borders. Every race, creed, no matter what your financial situation may be, every person is in danger, and no one seems to be immune to this problem. No matter how much that we wash our hands or buy hand sanitizer or Clorox or toilet paper, that doesn't help, so stop buying the toilet paper. I think one day we're going to laugh about the toilet paper. Nothing will cleanse us truly from this problem. It's a very serious situation. How many people will end up suffering because of this? Sadly, many people will suffer because they will not see what Jesus did for them up on Calvary. And the problem I'm talking about is not the coronavirus. It's sin. It's the pandemic of sin. It's our sin problem. We're hearing the word quarantine a lot. Sin is so restrictive. Sin can keep us quarantined, so to speak, in the bounds of sin. But through Jesus Christ and through the completed work of the cross, we can be set free from all that. We can be cleansed by the blood, just like we were hearing sung just a few moments ago. We can be healed from the effects of sin. Jesus will give your life something that this world is looking for. In this time of quarantine, it will give you an essential meaning and purpose. I wrote this down. If Satan tries to stop you and tells you that you have to go back into the quarantine of sin, you know what you can tell him? You can tell him that you belong to the King of Kings. Get out of your way. I have work to do for my Father, and it'll work every single time. Hallelujah for that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah for that. It'll work every time. You have an essential job of purpose and meaning. Each one of us has that. Well, let's look in our Bibles. Let's turn to our Bibles and look in Joshua chapter 5. We're going to be looking at the first 12 verses of this wonderful book. And beginning in verse 5, "And it came to pass, when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side of Jordan westward, and all the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Israel until we were passed over, that their heart melted, neither was their spirit in them any more because of the children of Israel. At that time the Lord said unto Joshua, Make thee sharp knives and circumcise again the children of Israel the second time. And Joshua made him sharp knives and circumcised the children of Israel at the heel of the foreskins. And verse 4 says, and this is the cause why Joshua did circumcise. All the people that came out of Egypt that were males, even all the men of war, died in the wilderness, by the way, after they came out of Egypt. Now, all the people that came out were circumcised, but all the people that were born in the wilderness, by the way, as they came forth out of Egypt, them they had not circumcised. For the children of Israel walked 40 years in the wilderness till all the people that were men of war, which came out of Egypt, were consumed, because they obeyed not the voice of the Lord, and to whom the Lord sware that he would not show them the land which the Lord sware unto their fathers, that he would give us, a land that floweth with milk and honey. Verse 7, and their children, whom he raised up in their stead, them Joshua circumcised, for they were uncircumcised, because they had not circumcised them by the way. And it came to pass, when they had done circumcising all the people that were abode in their places in the camp, till they were whole. And the Lord said unto Joshua, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from off you. Wherefore the name of the place is called Gilgal unto this day. And the children of Israel encamped in Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month, at even in the plains of Jericho. And they did eat of the old corn of the land on the morrow after the Passover, unleavened cakes and parched corn in the selfsame day. And in our last verse in our text today, verse 12, and the manna ceased on the morrow after they had eaten of the old corn of the land, and neither had the children of Israel manna any more, but they did eat of the fruit of the land of Canaan that year. Let us go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Ask His blessings upon the reading of His precious Word. Heavenly Father, I thank You once again, Lord. Lord, I pray that You would take Your Word, Your Holy Word, Your Scripture, Lord. Lord, I pray that You would just multiply it and magnify it in our sights this day, Lord. I pray that You would just let us see exactly what You would have us to see in your precious Word, Lord. I pray that You would give me the message, Lord, that Your people need to hear, that I need to hear. Lord, examine us today, Lord. Lord, as we receive Your message with grateful and glad hearts, Lord, I ask Your blessing upon the reading of Your precious Word in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. You know, I learned something interesting in Bible college several years ago that I thought was actually very amazing to learn. I learned that you can actually stop a train with one simple piece of wood we call commonly a 2x4. And I'm not talking about a toy train. I'm talking about a full-size train. And you say, well, Pastor, I've heard the saying that it's hard to stop a train. Now, I think that they use that for an advertisement for some type of air conditioning system or heating and cooling system. But the saying is true. It's hard to stop a train. I think it might be better said, more accurately said, it's hard to stop a moving train. Because what I'm getting at is that you can stop a train, a full-size train that carries hundreds of tons of freight, you can stop it from taking off with a simple 2x4 placed in its way, in front of the front of its wheels. Trains, interestingly, have a hard time taking off to begin with. As many of you know, they carry many cars, and they're all linked together one by one. And I've been told, in order for a train actually to take off, it must back up and gather all those links back together. And as it starts pulling the next link and the next link and the next link and the next link. And I've seen this in real life as well, in ministry. I've seen ministries that have been driven to a halt for whatever reason, for a multitude of reasons. And it seems like it's impossible to get that ministry to start back up again. It's called momentum. Once that you have momentum, that train could bust through a concrete block wall. And I've seen pictures of trains hitting full-size vehicles, if not only that, maybe even tractor trailers that would accidentally get stuck on the tracks, and the train would stop with all its might, or try to stop with all its might, and then it would just plow right through whatever would be in its way. It would be very hard to stop a moving train like that. And ministry is the same way. You know, church, I keep reminding us that we're moving forward for Christ. There's times that things slow us down a little bit at some times, just like what we're going through right now. No doubt, this is a change. This is something that has come up that we have had to bust through. But praise God, our church is moving forward for Christ, and we have been moving forward for Christ for several years now. This church has been moving forward for Christ for over 100 years. And so when these things, this is just a good example of what I'm preaching right now, is when these things like the coronavirus comes up and we've had to move our services from actually preaching to a congregation that I wish that I could be preaching to right now, we're having to use other means to reach people. But praise God, you're still there. You're still seeing this. Praise God for that. Amen to that. That's just a good example of what I'm trying to say, that we've built up some momentum. So when these things come up, yes, it changes things the way we're doing it, but praise God, we're still moving forward. It's called momentum, that we built up some momentum, that just like that train, that once it gets moving, it's hard. Just like I mentioned before, I've seen ministry projects get stopped for various reasons, and it was hard to prevent sometimes these things or obstacles coming up. And they were hard to get started up again. It seems like that it's been hard to ever get started back again. But with God's help, that they will. It's those little links that have to pull back together. And it's just another example of God's perfect timing. I've certainly seen churches or ministries have things that come up that really grinds them and actually brings the church almost to a stop or to a halt. And it's hard to get that picked back up again. But with God's help, nothing is impossible with God. What's impossible for man is always possible for God. You remember, God can do anything. And you say, well, Pastor, why are you bringing up this momentum? Why are you preaching about trains and automobiles and tractor trailers? Well, that's exactly where we find our people in our text today. They had built up this momentum. They had been in the wilderness for 40 years. They had been wandering. And finally, after crossing the Red Sea 40 years prior and wandering for those 40 years, finally, they've started moving forward for Christ. They've started moving forward for the Lord. They've started moving forward. It's a new generation. It's a younger, a leaner group of people. They're full of energy. And now they're ready to conquer the land that God had promised Abraham. Oh, Father Abraham. And they knew it too. It was a promise to Father Abraham. But wait. Wait. Abraham had made a covenant with God, and they knew that too as just well. It had just been laid aside along with the Passover as well. They did observe the Passover the first year that they came into the wilderness. The Bible does record the second time the Passover was observed. In Numbers 9, in chapter 9, verse 5, it says, "And they kept the Passover on the 14th day of the first month, and even in the wilderness of Sinai, according to all that the Lord commanded Moses, so did the children of Israel." But 39 years later, God had dealt with them and taught them order. That is where and why the tabernacle was given to them, and all the instructions about the tabernacle that they were ordered, instructed to build and to maintain and to learn in, and to know that was the meeting place for them and God. And it was also representing the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in every way. The sacrifice that was going to be made in their future, it's now in our past. But it paid for all sin of mankind from the beginning to the end. From the beginning to the end of time is the Alpha and Omega. Revelations 1:8, Jesus Christ Himself said, "I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, I'm the Almighty. He is the Almighty. Amen to that. Jesus is the Almighty. No more manna. Now the produce of the land, God has given them. Something fresh, something new, something healthy. You know, we spoke about this manna. It was wonderful. It was given, of course, by God. All good and perfect things come from the Father above. And it was nutrition to them. But it was the same thing day after day. I've used this example, and I believe it's a good example of how that the Christian, the carnal Christian, would be wandering. And they would know a few Bible verses, but it was the same ones. It would be John 3:16, or it would be Romans 8:28, or it would be Psalms 23. Those things are nourishing. Those things are wonderful. Those scriptures are wonderful to do. And to know, and to tell, and to memorize, and to share. But God's Word is full of His precious Word. There's no ending to it, but it stays fresh and it's healthy. That's why when you eat a variety of different fruits and vegetables, and even meats, it gives you the variety of life. And that's what the Bible will give us. But never forget that the manna in the wilderness is actually a picture of Christ as well. John 6:35, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Now we know that when we open up our Bibles, many times I make this reference, that we're opening up and breaking the bread of life. That Jesus came and He is the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John chapter 1. And we know that Jesus is actually the bread of life. John 6:48, Jesus says exactly that. I am the bread of life. John 6:51 says, I am the living bread. You know, this book that I hold in my hand is a living book. It's alive because He is alive. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Now we see John 3:16 here. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in Him should never perish, should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus says, I freely lay it down. I lay it down on this blessed old cross. I freely give it. No man taketh it from me, but I give it. I give it. And so we see that Jesus, even Himself, is a representation of the bread of life. This sweet manna is actually a picture of Jesus Himself. The whiteness, the purity, Exodus 16:31 even describes manna. Have you ever wondered what manna tastes like? Oh, I think, you know, we joke sometimes, I think the Greek word for manna is crispocremo, and I'm sure that some of you are probably laughing out there a little bit, but it is. There is a little bit descriptive in here in Exodus 16:31, and the house of Israel called the name thereof manna. And it was like a coriander seed. It was white, and the taste of it was like wafers made with honey. And now white is the color of milk. And remember, we're heading to the land of milk and honey, where the milk and honey flow. And the wafers that tasted like honey, again, we're headed to a land where the milk and honey are flowing. That is where we're going, right? Canaan land is just in sight. That is what God desired for them. And He desires that for us as well, to be where the milk and honey is flowing. Everything's going great. Progress is being made. We're finally are out of the wilderness, wandering. We're ready to move. We know we can eat more of the good things that God has for us. There's more to see. There's more to do. Let's go. We have momentum. Nothing can stop us now. But God's hand. God threw a red light up. God threw a stop sign up. God says stop. We're ready to face our enemy, God. We can face anything right now. God says before you face your enemy, you first are going to face a knife. There's going to be pain, but there's going to be a healing involved in that as well. But there's going to be a time of stopping. Is that not what we're finding ourselves today? We're finding ourselves, our lives are disruptive. Some of the things that we were used to doing has come to a grinding halt. Even some of the ministries of our church. Now, praise God, some of them are still going forward. And some of them are still going strong. To the fact that we're able to get in our vehicles and actually come to our fellowship meals, I miss that. That we can come and gather around and do a small group Bible study on Sunday mornings and Wednesday. I miss that. The fact that I can look out over the congregation, to the pews, and know where each of you are, that you sit, and you're not there. That has come to a grinding halt, and it hurts. It hurts me. But there must be a reason, because this did not take God by surprise. And there's a reason that God does everything. Let's continue on in the message. Maybe He's trying to tell us something. His word is so perfect. He's telling us something today. If we would just hear and we'll listen, let's open our ears today. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 16 gives us this word of circumcision. It's a physical sign, but it's got a spiritual meaning. Deuteronomy 10, 16 says, "Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart, and be no more stiff-necked." In Jeremiah 4:4, "Circumcise yourself to the Lord and take away the foreskins of your heart," of our heart. Let's allow God today to put us under the knife, so to speak, spiritually. And let's let Him carve away some of the flesh that doesn't belong. Some of the flesh that doesn't have a reason for being there. We have to remove what doesn't belong in our lives. It can hurt. Like I mentioned before, there's going to be pain involved. Some of those things have been there a while. Hebrews 4:12 says, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Of the heart. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Can the coronavirus fit into the scriptures? I'm sure many of us have thought of this week. Where does this fall into God's word, what we're going through, Pastor? Well, we know Romans 8:28, and we all know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Well, we've been stopped from certain things, haven't we? Regular church services have been stopped. God has grounded many right now. Many businesses have come to a complete halt or to stop. Listen, church. You might be listening to me for the very first time, stranger, Mr., Mrs. I believe God is using this time of maybe extra time at home, maybe extra time that we wouldn't have had otherwise, to show us something, to examine us, for us to examine ourselves. I believe that Romans 8:28 can certainly be applied as long as we take it in its full context. We don't never need to stop with one verse in Scripture. Even John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved." That's John 3:16 and 17. So what are you saying? Let's continue on. Let's read Romans 8:29 and 30. "For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren." Now, before we move on to verse 30, let me break this down just a little bit. In Genesis, God in the Trinity, God is the Godhead, and Jesus was in the beginning, and the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. There's John 1 again coming back up. You can't get away from this. But the Trinity was in the beginning, and they did say, "Let us make man in our own image." We began in His image, but because of the fall of man, the sin, the pandemic of sin, let's start using some words that we're familiar with, okay? That sin is it quarantines us, it separates us, it's confining. But let's look to be conformed to the image of His Son. So Romans 8:28 falls right into verse 8:29. Romans 8:29. He did predestinate us to be conformed back to the image of His Son. So don't you think that maybe the things that we go through in Romans 8:28, and we all know that all things, the good, the bad, the ugly, all things can work together or do work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to their purposes. No, the Bible doesn't say that. According to His purpose. And His purpose is conforming us back to get back to the image of His Son. Verse 30, let's put all this together. Verse 30, Romans 8:30 says, "Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called." Thank you, Jesus, for calling us. Thank you for saving us. "And whom He called, them He also justified." And whom He justified, and that means saved out there. The them that He saved, them He also glorified. He's given us a glorified being, that one day that we're going to be glorified. That means that we're going to be in glory. That means we're going to heaven. He's given us a home in heaven. He's went away just for a short period of time to prepare a place for us. Not just to go away and prepare a nice place for us that we could just have a nice retirement one day for eternity. But here's the thing. With Jesus, He wants to be with us. "I go away to prepare a place for you. And if I go away and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself." That guess what? That where I am, there you may be also. He wants to be with us. I love that. You know, we think about that precious verse, and we had our Bible study last Wednesday night. I hope you had a chance to see that and to study along with us. We actually took it from John chapter 14 instead of verses 1 through 6. We actually went from 1 through 7. And what a deeper meaning that actually that seventh verse even gave us into that. And what a wonderful study that was. But, you know, we talk about that precious scripture in the Bible of John chapter 14. And we see in my Father's house are many mansions. Well, people's already got one picked out. They've got, "I want one that looks just like the Biltmore house. I want one that looks just like this. I've got want one," you know, and that we even sing songs about that. You know what? That's nice. In my Father's house, I believe Jesus. I believe every word of that. In my Father's house are many mansions. That's very descriptive to me, that it's a beautiful place. There's a lot of descriptive saying or scriptures in our Bible about what heaven's going to be like. It's just a fraction of what it's actually going to be like, church. But I will tell you this, it's beautiful. It's wonderful. And yes, you want to go there. And I would just want to say this, instead of having a mansion of my very own, I just want to be where Jesus is. Being with Jesus is the grandeur of heaven. That is it for me. That is my mansion. It's just being with Jesus. But we're to be back to conform to the image of His Son. We're made in His image. But sin has corrupted us. Sin has put on more that needs that does not need to be there. Sin has engulfed us. There's no one, as I began in our introduction today, there's no one that's not affected by what's going on right now. This pandemic has affected everyone. And I'm not talking about the coronavirus. I'm talking about the pandemic of sin. And we would need to allow God to come in today. Allow God to do this for you today. And allow Him to work in your life. Church, we need to let God come into our hearts today. And just like Psalms 51, "Prepare in me a clean heart, O God. Restore unto thy salvation, the joy of thy salvation. Restore that unto us. Take away, remove the things that don't belong." There's many times as a pastor, and is one that tries my best to give the messages that come straight from God to the congregation. There's many times that I want to be that encourager, to that strengthener, that something that gives you just a little bit extra pep in your step as you walk out the doors. But church, I have to be honest with you. There's going to be times that I'm going to have to stand here and I'm going to have to preach the Word of God unapologetically. Amen. And there's going to be times that we're going to be leaving, and myself included in this, there's times that we leave this building that with our heads down, because we know that we were cut. The Bible says that God's Word is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it can cut. And it's cut me before, and it needs to. But just like any other thing, as we have a cut that may be on our hand, you know, God has given us, you know, we know that we complain a lot about being in the flesh, and I can't wait to go to heaven and get out of this fleshly body. But you know, God being the great Creator, amen, and being the Creator of these bodies that we are actually in, they're amazing. Our eyes and some of the things that our brain can do, and just the complexity of our, even if some of our organs and what they can do. But when we get a cut on our hand and we even bleed, with the proper care and the proper application and the proper cleansing, what happens? What happens in that? There comes a healing, and then it doesn't hurt anymore. Sometimes it leaves a scar, but there's a healing that comes from that, and that's what we're seeing today in the scriptures today, that these people, God's people, were brought to a halt, they were brought to a stop, and there was time to remove, to get them back to where that they needed to be before they could move forward. They had their Passover once again, and they had that right relationship back with God. You will not lose your relationship between you and God if you're a saved person out there, but you can lose that fellowship. And that's what I'm asking you today, is to examine yourselves and to allow God to come into your life, into your heart today, and go under the knife of this spiritual circumcision and allow Him to take away the things that do not belong. Whatever that is in your life, my life, that doesn't belong, let go and let God have His wonderful way. You know, you may be sitting at home while you're watching this today. You may be in the living room. You may be at the kitchen table, wherever you might be. Just bow your head. Get down beside that coffee table. Get down beside that couch. And that can become your altar today as we speak today, and just ask God, say, oh, please, God, please just take that knife of circumcision, Lord, spiritually. Lord, I pray that You would just take away, carve away from me all that doesn't belong. You know, so many times a woodworker, somebody would comment and say, oh, what a beautiful woodworking that you do. That looks just like whatever that they were making. I've seen people take chainsaws and carve out bears out of logs of wood. And the artist would say, and this would apply to many different artists, that sculptures, but they would say, oh, that's easy. I just remove everything that doesn't look like a bear. Oh, isn't that what God wants to do with us? Isn't that what God would desire for us today, is just to remove everything that doesn't look like His darling Son? If you've never asked Jesus, I beg you today, if you've never asked Jesus to come in your heart and be your Lord and Savior, today would be a wonderful day. Why don't you do it today? Why don't you just get down beside that coffee table? Why don't you get down beside that sofa? Why don't you get down beside that coffee? Why don't you get down beside that kitchen table today and just ask the Lord Jesus Christ to come in your heart? Acts 16:30-31, the Philippian jailer says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And Paul and Silas said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Admit you're a sinner. Call out, believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and ask the Lord, say, be merciful unto me, a little sinner. He's never turned one away. He's never cast one out that's ever came to Him. Call on Jesus today. Ask Jesus to save you. Lord, I pray. Say this prayer with me today, Lord. Say this prayer with me today if you've never asked Jesus to come in your heart. Say, Lord, please be merciful unto me, a little sinner. Lord, I pray that, you see my heart. You know my condition. You see what's there that doesn't belong. Lord, I pray that you remove it. Lord, I admit that I'm a sinner. Lord, I pray and Lord, I ask you to just save me, Lord. Lord, I confess with my mouth that I am a sinner, Lord. And I believe on your name, Lord. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for calling me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I love you, Jesus. In Jesus' precious name. If you said that prayer, I can give you beyond the authority of God's word itself that you are now a member of the family of God. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.
If you let go and let go.